Hello guys, today we are looking at the now 6-year-old huge spring ecosphere. You know, when I first made this ecosystem, I thought I would get a whole lot of use if I emphasized how big it was compared to most other closed ecosystems. Nowadays, I kind of forgot about that, and I also don't think it really matters. Anyway, I'm getting distracted already. You're here to hear about this closed ecosystem. This is what it looks like: a big jar with green water full of algae, a big plant, and some black dots swimming around. But it wasn't always like this, you know. A very, very brief history. When I made this self-sustaining ecosystem 6 years ago, it was the home of two plant species, Ambulia and Vellisneria, the grass-like one. There were many crustaceans living in it, like sea shrimp, daphnia, copepods and aquatic isopods, but also snails, tubifex worms and insects. A week later we saw hydra, leeches and what looked like a polychaete worm. After 2 weeks, the planarians appeared. At 4 months old, there was a planarian population bloom, but the daphnia had gone extinct, possibly due to the predation by the aquatic isopods. When the ecosystem was a year old, the Ambulia, one of the plants, as well as a few animals such as the copepods, aquatic mites and tubifex, aka the boogie worms, went extinct in this closed ecosystem. After 2 years, the leeches, hydra and aquatic isopods were gone as well. The ecosystem now consisted of Vellisneria, algae, bladder snails, ostracods, planaria, a small aquatic mite, and of course, microbes. When the ecosystem was 3 years old, 3 years ago now, not much had changed anymore. All the same species as a year earlier were still there, except for the small mite. It seemed that this ecosystem had finally reached a balanced state, in which all organisms were able to sustain themselves and or each other, resulting in a self-sustaining closed ecosystem with at least a seemingly stable biodiversity. There were quite a lot of plants and there was a lot of algae growth. That was the last update you saw. About a year ago, when the ecosystem was 5 years old, this is what it looked like. Sadly, the planaria had gone extinct as well, and there was only one little Vellisneria left. The photosynthetic life consisted mostly of a lot of filamentous algae. Apart from the smaller ostracods, or sea shrimp, that were abundant during the entirety of this ecosystem's life, there was now also a very large population of these larger ostracods. They were mostly burrowing in the large sediment layer. They must have been in this ecosystem before, but never this abundant. Interesting. And now, the ecosystem at 6 years old. So, this is what it looks like. A green soup with the Vellisneria in it. Nearly all the filamentous algae have died and decomposed. It seems like they kind of switched places with the unicellular algae that are now very abundant and are turning the water green. Apart from the plants, something has to remove the nutrients from the water. It's interesting that it took 6 years before the water turned green. Some of my other ecospheres started very green in the beginning, or seemed to have seasonal changes, sometimes being clear, sometimes being green. But this jar only turned green now, after having been seemingly stable for years. Interesting. All this weird stuff on the glass is whatever's left of the thread algae, and the little black dots are, I think, where they were attached to the glass. It looks kinda neat until you view it with light from the front and not from the back. Then it looks like mold, which it isn't. There also seems to be some sort of jelly on the inside of the glass above the waterline, which I think is some kind of algae or decaying matter. Just look how big the detritus layer on top of the sediment has become. All the organisms that were once alive, but aren't anymore, are now inside that layer, or inside of other organisms in this ecosystem. And look at those tunnels! The plant in this ecosystem, like mentioned before, is a Vallisneria. It is one of the two plants initially present in this jar. In a way, it is and isn't the same plant as I planted in here. Physically, it isn't the same plant. That one is long gone. But genetically, it is identical. Vallisneria can reproduce sexually with flowers and seeds, but in aquariums and jars, in my experience, they'll reproduce by producing runners. They're basically cloning themselves. That is also why they do so well in closed ecosystems, in my experience. They can spread easily without intervention. A fun fact about these specific Vallisneria, which I think I've mentioned before, this individual plant is a clone of a clone of a clone of a clone of a plant I pulled from one of my aquariums 6 years ago. In turn, that plant was a clone of a clone of a clone and so on from a Vallisneria my father got when he started with the aquarium hobby over 4 years ago. I think that's kinda special. A year ago, it almost seemed like it was on the brink of extinction, so I'm happy to see it has bounced back. It looks like there's just two big ones growing on this side, but there's actually a little one growing on this side of the jar as well. Cute! It is a bit hard to see because of the unicellular algae in the water. I think the reason that the Vallisneria is growing tall again is the same reason that the unicellular algae bloom. What that reason is exactly, I don't know, but probably something spiked the available nutrients and possibly also carbon dioxide in the water. Something like the thread algae dying, for instance. But why did they die? That's a very good question. I don't have the answer. Perhaps they received too much or too little light. Maybe it got too hot or too cold. Or mayhaps there were too few animals present to produce enough nutrients and carbon dioxide for the algae to grow, which might also explain why the Vallisneria almost died completely. I would put my money on the last option, as any light or temperature swings didn't prove to be a problem in the past. But why were there so few animals? I don't know, man, stop asking so many questions. No, never stop asking questions, but moving on, let's take a look at some of these larger ostracods, or sea shrimp. Here you can see some swimming about. They are the only crustacean left in this ecosystem, as far as I know. If these are the only crustacean left, that means that the smaller ostracods are gone. That is unusual. If they are truly gone, this would make the spring ecosphere the first one I've ever had in which the smaller sea shrimp species, exact species unknown, went extinct. That is why I am kind of hesitant to believe they are gone, but I really haven't seen one in here for months. Anyway, there's still ostracods in this jar in the form of this bigger species, and they are ostracoding all over the place. Their primary function in this ecosystem is as detritivores, which we also talked about in the previous video. They are processing all the decaying organisms and turning them into poop, which microbes can convert back into nutrients. They are also feeding on microbes and algae, thereby acting as primary consumers. They allow nutrients from microbes and primary producers, such as algae, to be taken up by larger animals, by being eaten themselves. Except in this case, there's no predator left to prey on them anymore. Sad. But that's the way she goes, I guess. They are also providing the oxygen-producing organisms with CO2, by breathing. What this larger species is really fond of, contrary to the smaller one, is burrowing, as can be seen by all the tunnels they've dug. Like I said before, I don't know which exact species this is, or which genera or family even, to be honest. Some species are parthenogenetic, basically meaning that females clone themselves. In that case, almost all individuals in this ecosystem could be genetically identical, or there could be a few different sets of genes. But they could also have been reproducing sexually with their two penises or gonopores. Yeah. In the lower layers of this sediment, there's a lot of shed exoskeletons from individuals that have molted. Also a few dead ones, There's a lot to tell about how ostracods are the ultimate survivor in my closed ecosystems, but I think that that's a topic for its own video. Look at how pretty the sand has become, by the way. All those differently colored spots in the substrate are caused by different bacterial colonies. The black spots, for instance, are probably caused by bacteria that grow in anoxic conditions, so environments without any oxygen and high sulfide concentrations. I should probably make a Winogradsky column soon. Let's get back to the ostracods. But wait! What's that moving over there? Oh my, is that, could it be, are those, could they be, are those boogie worms? Oh yeah! But haven't they gone extinct in the first year of this ecosystem's life? Yes, they were gone for 5 years, only to return in the last few months. And look how many there are. They can be seen dancing in front of the glass all around the jar, and who knows how many there are in the middle of the jar. There must be thousands, if not tens of thousands. I had to select all the sea shrimp footage really carefully in order not to spoil this, because they are everywhere. I hear you asking, how? How did they suddenly reappear after so many years? I've been wondering the same. Unfortunately, I could not find a whole lot about tubifex reproduction, especially relating to the possibility of their eggs remaining dormant for a period of time, which was my first guess, dormant eggs. I also thought about the possibility of the boogie worms themselves being dormant, but again, I could not find any information about it. Of course, there also exists a possibility that they were always there and I've just missed them all this time. But that seems highly unlikely to me, not only because I really tend to see these things, but also because in my experience, there's never just one or a few tubifex worms present, but always quite a lot. So how they appeared remains a bit of a mystery. But why are they so abundant? Well, they feed on organic matter, floating in the water column. Just take a look at the water. It's chock full of organic matter, so lots to feed from. And no natural predators left in the ecosystem. That's a recipe for a population bloom. The reason they're moving back and forth is to make sure they stay in oxygen-rich water. They are very well adapted to low oxygen environments. In fact, they can survive for up to 2 days in anoxic conditions. They might look a little shorter than you're used to, but that's just because they've buried themselves in the sand and are going all the way through the detritus layer in order to reach the open water. So that's what this ecosystem looks like at 6 years of age. And yes, that also means that the bladder snails have gone extinct, or well, I should say, I haven't seen them in a while anymore. That's a bit crazy, as bladder snails are one of the most hardy ecosphere species out there. So, the biodiversity has gone down in this ecosystem quite a lot. The ecosystem now consists of the Vallisneria, algae, tubifex aka boogie worms, and ostracods. Both the boogie worms and the ostracods are well adapted to low oxygen conditions. That could be a coincidence, or it could be a sign. There could have been periods in this ecosystem's life where the amount of dissolved oxygen in this water was low, and these two animals were the only ones that could cope with that. Perchance. Ideally, I would want to make a closed ecosystem that monitors and measures the oxygen level in the ecosystem. But that's expensive, yo. So, share this video with everyone you know and subscribe. That's about it for the update on this 6-year-old huge self-sustaining closed spring ecosphere. I hope you were able to enjoy this journey as much as I did, and I'll see you in the next video. Bye!